Kei te whakarongo mai koe ki te reo irirangi o Aotearoa. This is Checkpoint on RNZ National. I'm Lisa Owen. E haere aki nei, should Westport rebuild or relocate? Hundreds of houses are flood damaged, leaving locals contemplating motorhomes and portable cabins. Meanwhile, cut-off Marlborough residents are waiting for roads to reopen. Escalating violence against police on the beat. The Royal Commission into Abuse focuses in on the Pacifica community. So-called Freedom Day dawns in the UK, but Boris Johnson is banged up in isolation as all COVID restrictions lift. We're live to the Olympics. Two South African footballers have tested positive for COVID. And in Dunedin, when it comes to doggy do, scoop the poop volunteers literally take matters into their own gloved hands.
RNZ News at 5, kia ora ko Susana Leata with DNA. The number of people made homeless by the devastating floods in Westport is still unclear as the clean-up continues. An estimated 2,000 people in the town were forced to evacuate over the weekend, and many sodden homes remain unlivable. For some people, today has been the first time they were able to go inside their flood-damaged homes in the northern end of the town. Among them was Stephen Sweetala, who lives on Romilly Street. Due to the severity of the damage, he says he won't be back home anytime soon.
I'll say it's going to be quite a while, because even the doors, and you can't even close the doors, they were warped in that as well. They'll have to be all redone. It is a complete devastation, yeah. It's disheartening, really.
The Buller District Council is yet to give all residents the all clear to return home. The mop-up continues in the Marlborough region as the scale of the devastation caused by the weekend's flooding emerges. Marlborough District Council says Queen Charlotte Drive will open for limited access to residents only. Waka Kotahi Transport Agency says only one highway remains closed at the top of the south, State Highway 63 from Renwick to Top House near St Arnott. Richard McNamara of Civil Defence says a bay-by-bay assessment of the Marlborough Sounds has been underway today. Two crew members on board the Matina container ship, currently stationed at Bluff, have tested positive for COVID-19. The Marshall Island-flagged vessel arrived last night, Harry Locke reports.
The two infected crew members who joined the ship in Singapore on July 2nd were given rapid tests as they were both symptomatic. The remaining 19 crew members have also been tested, and their results are due back later tonight. Southern DHB health officials are working with agencies to determine the next steps, with all crew members remaining on board the vessel. The Matina is currently in quarantine in a secure area of the port, inaccessible to the public. It comes after two other ships have arrived in New Zealand in the past week, carrying infected passengers, the Viking Bay in Wellington and the Playa Zahara in Lyttelton.
The Royal Commission into Abuse and Care of Pacific Peoples has been told it will give those responsible the chance to listen and to make genuine, meaningful change to prevent further abuse from occurring. The inquiry opened in South Auckland today. Lead Counsel Tania Sharkey says the theme of silence permeates the story of Pacific abuse.
Silence as to ethnicity, including the data and recording of ethnicity of Pacific peoples in Aotearoa. Silence as to shame and fear in a Pacific cultural context. Silence as to one's identity and well-being.
Tania Sharkey says Pacific peoples have been marginalised and trapped in cycles of socioeconomic deprivation. Victoria's latest lockdown will not end as planned tomorrow night, with 29 new cases of COVID-19 in the past 48 hours. Premier Daniel Andrews says the state government is not ready to lift the lockdown yet. He says he knows it's frustrating, but locking down has saved the state from thousands of cases.
I can't stand here now and tell you exactly what rules and what time frame will apply beyond midnight tomorrow night. This thing is moving so fast, it's so challenging, it's so dynamic, that we have to be on our guard, and we have to make sure that we make the best calls, because you only kind of get one chance to do that.
Victoria reported 13 new locally acquired cases today, and New South Wales 98. The police officer injured when he fell and hit his head during a fatal shooting in Hamilton remains in a stable condition in hospital. Officers were called to O'Donoghue Street in the suburb of Hillcrest on Wednesday night after a report of a man with a high-powered rifle. The police did not initially find him at the address, but when he returned, he got out of his car and fired at the officers. He was then shot by police and died at the scene. It's 4 minutes past five. Any misgivings All Blacks coach Ian Foster had about TJ Perenara appear to have been put aside with the scrum half recalled to the national squad for the Bledisloe Cup and Rugby Championship. Perenara was unavailable for the tests against Tonga and Fiji, having skipped Super Rugby for a stint in Japan. Perenara earned the ire of Foster for the way he handled the renegotiation of his contract and publicly stated he was considering a move to Rugby League before eventually re-signing with New Zealand Rugby.
I wasn't personally overly impressed that played out publicly. I made that point to him. I didn't like the senior All Black coming out and saying he was thinking of leaving, but I mean that's all part of a negotiation ploy, I guess.
The Football Ferns captain Ali Riley says they feel privileged to be the first New Zealand athletes in action at the Tokyo Olympics. With the football tournament starting prior to Friday's opening ceremony, the Ferns open their campaign on Wednesday against Australia at Tokyo Stadium.
To just be a couple days out from the first game after waiting 5 years is so amazing. It's such a great feeling. It's so exciting. It's a huge honour to be here. It's a privilege, especially during what's going on in the world, to be here and representing New Zealand.
Lose tonight and the Northern Stars will drop out of contention for the ANZ Netball Premiership title. The fourth-placed Stars play the Southern Steel in Papakura, with the third-placed Steel able to confirm a playoff spot with victory. That's the news.
Westport washed out.
Not since the 1968 earthquake in Westport has the whole town been affected like this, so it is a big hit.
Marlborough mops up.
There's a lot of surface water around and there's a lot of damage.
Floods too in Germany, where the Chancellor joins the dots.
Ich bin heute hierher gekommen.
It all suggests that it has something to do with climate change. We have to hurry.
Weather the Storm with Morning Report, weekdays from 6 on RNZ National.
Now, the short forecast from Met Service till midnight tomorrow. Northland to Manawatu, including Coromandel Peninsula, Bay of Plenty and Central High Country. Showers becoming isolated and retreating to the west coast north of Taranaki tomorrow morning, becoming fine elsewhere. Gisborne to Wairarapa, also Horowhenua to Wellington, partly cloudy. Isolated showers clearing tomorrow. Bulla, Westland and Fiordland mainly fine tonight. Isolated showers in Western Fiordland, also developing north of Hokitika this evening. Isolated showers everywhere tomorrow night, turning to rain in the south. Nelson and Marlborough, fine apart from isolated showers this evening. Canterbury, patchy drizzle gradually clearing tonight. Low cloud tomorrow, clearing inland in the morning. Otago and Southland, fine apart from areas of low cloud or fog. And Chatham Islands, rain, possibly heavy, easing tonight, then turning to showers tomorrow afternoon. RNZ National, it's 7 minutes past five.
Kia ora rā, Susanna. Tēnā koutou katoa, no mai haere mai ki checkpoint I tēnei rā, ko Lisa Owen tēnei. Some Westport residents have returned to see the full scale of the damage to their properties from this weekend's flooding. Many sodden homes remain unlivable, their occupants forced to doss down in emergency centres for another night. After days of heavy rain, the sunshine's back, but with it, a picture of the full scale of the disaster. It's led some to call for the town itself to look for a new home. Anai te kaere poata a Ananzaki a Westport.
Recent retiree Stephen Switala only moved to Westport last year to be closer to his father-in-law. He never expected to be in this situation. Mr. Switala's house on the northern end of Romilly Street, which is among the worst affected areas, had water about 30 centimetres high during the peak of the flood. This afternoon, he was allowed back inside.
He ran into the garage and come through into the bathroom there. And it's been up past the walls there.
So we're in the dining area now. It looks like quite a bit.
There's still water sitting in the kitchen there as well. On the vinyl there, there's still water laying there. And we have to take photos as well for the insurance company. And photo all the water marks to show how high it has been up in there. You can feel it on your feet there in the carpet there.
For Stephen Switala, the damage is hard to take in. He won't be back home anytime soon.
I'll say it's going to be quite a while because even the doors, and you can't even close the doors, they are warped in there as well. They'll have to be all redone. It is a complete devastation there. It's disheartening, really.
Stuck at the local Salvation Army Centre for the past few nights has been Pete Lusk, whose house on Derby Street is also damaged by the flood. He says authorities need to be more upfront about the flood risk in the town.
When you move to Westport, and the river's in flood, you are on an island and the bridges can be closed, which they were. So if the water kept rising, virtually everyone in this town of 6,000 would be flooded out. But luckily the river didn't keep rising.
Pete Lusk thinks the entire town of Westport should be shifted due to the danger posed by the floods.
This town will have to be moved. There's no doubt in my mind, because all along the coast in Buller, they're building rock walls to keep the sea back because the sea's rising. And I believe that these storms will become more frequent.
74-year-old Lorraine Williams is also spending another night at a welfare centre, but she wishes she was told more about the danger floods pose to her house before she bought it a few years ago.
It should have, because when we bought ours, the land agent never told us. And if she had, we might not have bought that house. A bit annoyed when it happened, yes, but, well, as they say, it's life.
Lorraine Williams says right now the important thing is being able to survive the ordeal.
At least we're still all alive. It's stupid and it's hard to say, but it's just a house. And, okay, it's hard at the time, but you just got to keep going.
Lorraine Williams says she will move to a motel tomorrow night, meaning she can finally move out of the welfare centre. Despite some people being able to leave, the Buller District Council was unable to say how many people will be at welfare centres tonight.
And we'll talk to the Buller Mayor a little later in the program. In the meantime, homai o whakaaro, we would love to hear your feedback. Nō reira anei nā kaupapa mō te hōtaka nei. Tell us whether you think it's time to move Westport, like literally shift the town, and other flood-prone towns, as some of the people there are suggesting. Pātui mai, send me a text, 2101. You can tweet us at checkpointrnz or email checkpoints@rnz.co.nz. Two more crew on another container ship have tested positive for COVID-19. The ship arrived in Port at Bluff on Sunday night and the 21 crew were tested this morning. Our reporter Nick Trubridge is live in the studio with me now. Nick, what's going on with this ship?
Yeah, so as you said, Lisa, this ship arrived in Bluff last night. Two of the crew have tested positive, and there are 21 crew on this boat in total. So still waiting on the results for the rest of them. The health officials have told us that they'll be due back later tonight. As you mentioned, the ship is in Bluff. It's been shifted to an area of the port that is sort of closed off from any activity. They're going to, I suppose, sort of fence off the ship so no one can go on and off. Effectively a floating MIQ, I guess you could say. But you said 21 crew still on there, and worth noting also, this is the third, let's call it COVID ship that's arrived in New Zealand in recent days, or recent weeks rather. Of course, we had the Viking Bay that arrived in Wellington. I believe that was 16 of the crew there have tested positive. And then also after that, the Player Zahara in Christchurch, where 13 of the crew have tested positive. So I suppose a trend that we've seen continue over the next last few weeks.
And no news yet what they'll do if there are more crew, where they'll get bundled off to?
No news yet. Still waiting on that. So okay. Yeah, we'll keep you abreast of that.
So other COVID developments, more Pfizer vaccine ahead of schedule. What can you tell us?
Yeah, 370,000 doses reached New Zealand last night. They're already being distributed around the country to areas that are, you know, short on doses. I believe it was 15 sites have already received stock. Another 104 to receive stock through the rest of the day. The Health Minister, or COVID Response Minister rather, Chris Hipkins, has, you know, used this as an opportunity to sort of emphasise the fact that the rollout remains 6% ahead of schedule. But of course, you know, that's what the Minister says in his press release, but you go to some of these sites around the country. We were down in Manurewa last week or the week before, and people will still tell you, people who are in Group 2 even, will still tell you that it is still difficult. They bring up the 800 number, can't necessarily get through, have to actually go down physically to the site to actually get the jab. So, look, good news, more doses arriving, but access issues still seemingly a problem. The Minister's also said that there are further shipments due last 2 weeks of July and then last 2 weeks of August as well.
OK. And is there any news on the Trans-Tasman bubble? We were expecting an update today, but where are we at with that?
Yeah, so waiting on that tonight, as you say. I mean, it's worth noting, though, that Melbourne has not lifted its lockdown. So, as you can imagine, that probably means New Zealand's resumption of the bubble is probably looking, it's probably not going to happen, is it, until things tidy up there. But as you say, we'll have developments on that later on.
Okay, we'll keep everybody posted. Thanks, Nick. That's Nick Troubridge there, updating the situation with that container ship, two people positive for COVID-19. And as Nick said, the third ship to have a situation, a scenario like that. Now, let's return to our top story now about the flooding in Westport. Some residents have been able to return to their homes today, but others are spending another night in emergency accommodation. Well, joining me now is the Buller District Mayor, Jamie Klein. Hi, Jamie. How are things looking today?
Good evening. Much improved as people are starting to return to their homes, which is great to see. And we're starting to get a little bit of a handle on what sort of quantum of accommodation, a little bit of a feel for how that might look longer term.
Yeah, tell me about that. How many people have houses that really are unlivable right now? They're going to need somewhere else.
Yeah, I don't have a real hard number on that. It could be, listening to the team here coming back, it could be sort of 50 to 100 at this stage. Over 2,000 people have been cleared to return by the USAR crew. And we've still got well over 100 odd in our welfare centres for tonight, by the look of it.
So even if it is around 50 to 100, that's a lot of people when you've got a squeeze on housing in your area anyway. So what are you seriously considering in terms of options to put a roof over their heads?
We haven't got any hard detail on that yet. It depends on whether some of these are going to be long, long term or, just a few weeks. What we do know, there's very limited accommodation here. So, it may be that we reach out to the government for further support around that. Some kind of solution, camper vans, motorhomes, maybe.
Have you had any of those discussions yet, Jamie? I know it's early days, but around portable, porta-coms, porta-cabins, call them what you will.
We've had some discussions with the military, who don't have an immediate resource available to deploy. So I imagine the team will be considering, things like that, porta-coms, portable housing. It's difficult to quantify until you know exactly what sort of numbers you're dealing with.
How long would it take you to stand something like that up, even if you went to motorhomes, for example?
I would imagine motorhomes could be here within 24 hours.
Okay, we've talked to some residents today and they're querying whether you should be, refurbishing these properties that have been damaged or whether this is the opportunity to think about moving Westport basically to higher ground. What do you think?
I think we need a bit of time to step back and consider those kind of things. I mean, there's no doubt there's some houses that it's arguable you shouldn't be rebuilding on. And I think probably the market will determine that.
So whereabouts are those properties and are you going to basically red zone them?
That'll be a decision that might have to be made depending on what the building inspectors, consider on their houses in terms of red stickering houses. Red zoning, we haven't had time for those discussions yet, but there are houses that have been flooded multiple times now. So, you need to step back and think, is there additional flood protection measures that could be done or is there just parts of the town that should be, retreated from? That's a discussion for another day, not today.
Jamie, how many houses do you reckon might fall into that category right now?
Oh, no idea.
Okay. So the other thing is just how much information is on LIMS in your area, for example, about high-risk flood areas. Would everyone who's purchased a house there, would they have known that it's in a flood zone?
I don't have that detail, but there are a lot of houses this time around that have flooded for the very first time, but there are a number that have flooded in the last couple of years, so you wouldn't have had to talk to very many locals to understand the risk on some properties.
So those people who have been flooded for the first time round, what does that tell you about how things are changing?
Absolutely. Yeah. No, this is a classic extreme weather event, and we're seeing more of them. Last 10 years, I've seen, significant wind events, tidal surges, and now a flood like this. So it's, this is welcome to our world.
Jamie, what's your timeline, do you reckon, for making decisions on those properties that you think might be borderline for rebuilding, fixing up? That might be it for them.
I don't know. That's a big discussion, and there's lots of factors to that, around people's desire to want to do them, the market's ability to sell them, insurance companies' desire to insure them. You know, there's a number of factors there.
Appreciate your time, Jamie. That's Jamie Klein, who is the Bullard District Mayor there. It is 19 minutes past five, and you're with Checkpoint on RNZ National. Kia ora rawatu mo te whakarongo mai e haere ake nei. A voluntary dog poo patrol deals with a, well, pretty crappy situation in Dunedin. It's just a few days until the Olympics get underway in Tokyo, and COVID cases have emerged in the athletes' village. Ko taku hoa anai nei ko Maya Burry, who's in Tokyo covering the games. Kia ora, Maya.
Kia ora, Lisa.
Hey, what can you tell us about those athletes who have COVID?
Yeah, so the big news yesterday, two athletes testing positive for COVID-19 in the athletes' village. We've since learnt that they're two football players from the South African men's team. So what happens now is that the whole football team, they are shipped out of the village and they've now been sent to a hotel quarantine facility. That essentially means that their team won't be able to do any training until they've been cleared. So a big process underway there, and also another part of that process is their close contacts are then traced. So anyone in the village that may have come close to them would also have to be tested. The good news is no New Zealand athletes caught up in this, but I guess it just highlights just how sort of dynamic, for want of a better word, this Olympics is. If this had happened closer to game time, maybe the whole team would have missed the game. We've also seen US tennis star Coco Gauff have to pull out of the Olympics because of a positive COVID test in the US. So plenty happening, and the games haven't even started yet.
Yeah, and you've been speaking to some of the football ferns today. I mean, what are they saying about their experience so far in the village?
Well, they were actually one of the first groups to arrive to the village because their game kicks off on Wednesday, so you have to arrive, I think it's a maximum of 5 days before your game starts. So they arrived to a pretty quiet village, they told us today. Since then, everyone else has been moving in, thousands of athletes. So it's really changed. They talked about the dining hall initially being quite quiet. Now it's packed. And so it's really about making sure that they're following all the restrictions and measures that they have in place. They're planning to only go to the dining hall during the less busy times, masks, social distancing, all of those sort of things. And NZOC chef, the NZOC's Rob Waddell, he said that, look, they did expect cases in the village, so it's really just about making sure that they're following all those protocols.
So football ferns, you know, one of the first into the village and first onto the field to compete too.
That's right. So they're not really travelling too far in terms of when it comes to their competitors, Australia. They're meeting Australia on the field for their first game. That is going to be a big game. They're in a tough pool, and so this is an important one for them. Earlier today, we spoke to Ali Riley, who's the Football Ferns captain, and she said that after such a long journey to Tokyo 2020, they're feeling excited and nervous to get underway.
I think it's fun that obviously the football starts before the rest of the games. You know, we'll be in bed before our second game when the opening ceremony happens. But no, I hope that the team, that the country can really rally behind our team. Obviously, hosting a World Cup just in 2 years, this is really important for our preparation and building into something really special and really major for New Zealand.
And Maya, so you've been in Tokyo for a few days now. I mean, what can you tell us about kind of what a COVID Olympics looks like?
Well, I think obviously it's an Olympics with a lot of restrictions. We arrived 4 days ago, just to give you an idea of sort of the paperwork that's going into this. I think there were 10 checkpoints at the airport, which took 5 hours to get through here in Tokyo before we were then escorted onto a bus and sent to our hotel for 3 days of quarantine. Today is our first day where we've actually been able to go to the main press centre and speak to some of these New Zealand athletes. And so, temperature checks, which are particularly challenging, you have to get below 37.5 degrees. At the moment it's 34 degrees here in Tokyo, so it's really hot, so you have to be making sure that you're keeping cool. It's definitely a very restricted environment. The athletes are undergoing daily testing, a lot of controls in place here.
Good to talk to you, Maya. That is Maya Burry joining us live from Tokyo there with the countdown to the Olympics well and truly on. It is 24 minutes past five. Kia mo tonu mai. You're listening to Checkpoint on RNZ National. A voluntary poo patrol has scooped up kilograms of doggy doo from Dunedin's popular West Harbour walkway. A few weeks back, we spoke to Antonia Wood, who lives with her family in St Leonard's, and they're regular users of the track. Now, she'd had enough of scraping dog feces off her young kids, their shoes, her shoes, and so on. So she actually highlighted every last doggy discard along that track to show how crappy the situation is. And on the weekend, Antonia and a group of Scoop the Poop volunteers literally took matters into their own gloved hands.
And we had 10 people turn up on the day, and I had pre-highlighted all the poo along the 5 kilometre walkway, then allocated the walkway into sections, so each volunteer took a different section and took some compostable bags and a trowel and gloves and cleaned up all the poo along that section, and we got the whole 5K.
Antonia, when you say that you had pre-highlighted the poo, for those not in the know, what do you mean?
So I spray-painted all the dog poo along the West Harbour walkway from St Leonard to town with some water-soluble high-vis spray paint, just to highlight how many dog poos there actually were, and also so other people weren't going to stand in them like we had been doing.
Were there extra ones? On top of the ones that you'd spray-painted, was there more poo since you did that?
Well, I actually finished spray-painting the morning of the clean-up, so I think we had them all covered.
What was the yield? What did you come away with?
Yeah, we filled two large plastic tubs with our compostable bags from everybody's collection, and we think that we came to about 30 kilograms of dog poo.
30 kilos?
Yeah.
So what's the deal then? Do people not get the message, or do they think that the message doesn't apply to them in terms of taking away their dog do?
Yeah, I think that some people think that they don't need to remove it, that just flicking it off onto the side of the path is okay. And I think some people aren't looking at their dogs the whole time that they're walking, so they might not have them on a lead and see that they're pooing, and so don't see the poo to pick up. So, I think it's a combination of just lack of responsibility, or people thinking that that's okay, even though it's right there on the path or next to the path where kids explore and look into the lagoon to see the wildlife and seals and everything. So I hope that this is raising awareness that actually it is a responsibility. We've got the DCC involved, and they've been really supportive and put up extra signs. So we've now got a whole lot of signs along the walkway about scooping the poop and keeping your dogs on a lead. So I hope that will help.
Just so that I'm fully getting this in terms of the volume that you collected, how many kilos over what distance?
So 30 kilos over 5 kilometres. We could hardly lift the tub at the end of the cleanup.
So what are you going to do with the dog poo?
Well, we've taken it back to my place, and I'm just going to dig a hole on our section in the bush and bury it. So I've got that job to do next.
Basically, everybody else's problem has kind of become your problem, Antonia.
Well, yeah, I hope it's a short-term problem. I hope that this raises awareness of the responsibility of dog walkers, and that we won't have to keep doing this because we just want the dog walkers to take their own poos home.
Hopefully, this will be the last time. How confident are you about that?
We'll see. Yeah, I mean, I'm optimistic. Yeah, because we've had lots of positive feedback. As I say, the DCC have been right behind us and helping out. They even sent a dog control staff member along yesterday, and they helped collect the poo and rubbish as well. We had a whole pile of rubbish collected by all our poo collectors at the same time, so the volunteers did a fantastic effort. So I'd like to think that it would make a long-term difference.
Did the council mention if they've handed out many or any infringements for that stretch?
No. There's signage that says you can be fined up to $300 if you don't scoop the poop. But as far as I know,
no fines have been given out.
And that was poo scooper Antonia Wood. Checkpoint. Violent criminal behaviour is ramping up like never before, according to the police commissioner. So-called Freedom Day is dawning in the UK. All COVID restrictions are lifting, despite the number of cases growing through the roof and Boris Johnson being in isolation. And we smell a rat at a cheese-tasting competition of a different kind. Homai o Whakaaro. Love to hear your feedback on that interview that we just did about the 30 kilos of dog poo picked up by one walkway down in Dunedin. Is it an issue around your place? Are people not picking up after their canines? Text us on 2101, tweet us at checkpointrnz, or you can email us checkpoint@rnz.co.nz. It is time now for the headlines with Susanna.
Up to 100 people are still homeless following the devastating floods in Westport as the cleanup at the top of the South Island continues. An estimated 2,000 people in the town were forced to evacuate over the weekend. The Buller District Mayor Jamie Klein told Checkpoint between 50 and 100 homes were currently unlivable, but the majority of people were cleared to return. Mr Klein says it was still too early to determine on how long people will be out of their houses. The Marlborough region also continues its mop-up, with civil defence staff going bay to bay today to determine the damage. Two crew members on board a container ship in quarantine in Blouth have tested positive for COVID-19, with results for the remaining 19 expected later tonight. The Martina came into port last night and all 21 crew members were tested this morning. The two infected crew members, who joined the ship in Singapore on July 2nd, were given rapid tests as they were both symptomatic. All of the crew remain on board, with Southern District Health Board officials working to determine the next steps. The ship is in a secure area of the port, inaccessible to the public. The COVID-19 response minister says the largest shipment of Pfizer vaccine to date has arrived just in time. About 370,000 doses arrived in New Zealand yesterday and are being delivered to vaccination centres. The minister, Chris Hipkins, says the shipment arrived ahead of schedule after officials managed to get it on an earlier flight from Singapore. He says margins were getting tight in some larger population areas towards the end of last week. The Royal Commission into Abuse in Care of Pacific Peoples has been told that silence pervaded the experience of the children abused. The inquiry opened in South Auckland today. Lead counsel Tania Sharkey has told the inquiry it will give those responsible the chance to listen and to make meaningful change to prevent further abuse from occurring. Those are the latest news headlines from RNZ National. Our next news and weather update is at 6.
Kia ora, e ho, no mai, hoki mai. This is Checkpoint, ko Lisa Owen tēnei. Ko taku hoa, nāianei, ko Nona Peltier, who is here to talk business. And interest rates again, Nona. Pressure is continuing to build. So what is the latest?
So on Friday, we had the performance of manufacturing index, which is basically how the performance is going from the manufacturing sector. It was going very strongly, and we know that that now has been compounded by an incredibly high number for the services sector as well. So just about 3 months ago, we were seeing hardly any growth and expansion in that mm-hmm. area. And today, we've now, for the fourth month in a row, seen really strong sales and orders. And this is an increase of 2.3 points to 58.6. That's well above the long-term average. And it's showing there's very large numbers of new orders and so on. And we're talking about numbers that we haven't seen since the June quarter of 2007. These are, pre-GFC. So anyway, the indicators are really strong, and that shows that perhaps the Reserve Bank may have to act even sooner than expected on interest rates. These numbers indicate economic growth of 4%, and that is really at capacity for New Zealand. And the constraints that we're seeing are on the supply side and also on the labour side.
Yep, closed borders and people complaining they can't get enough workers.
And that would be, even if that wasn't the case, at these numbers, that indicates that we're at a point where inflation is most likely to rise. And so that's not just the kind of inflation you can look through. This is the kind of inflation that is core to the economic position. So, the Reserve Bank is more than likely then not going to raise interest rates next month. And then could possibly have raised the official cash rate from 0.25% today to 1% by the end of this year and 2% by the following year. So watch this space. And for sure, if you're looking at your debt position, keep that in mind and look at how you can reduce your costs.
Okay, let's move on to Fonterra, right? So it has revised the changes it initially proposed around its capital structure because it was sort of basically having an overhaul, wasn't it?
Yeah, and it really didn't go down well initially. So that's because there is a problem. Fonterra has recognized that for its cooperative, it really does need to review its capital structure so that farmers continue to own the cooperative. Well, so they say that the consultation process, which is started in May, has at least had farmers start to focus on the solutions rather than just the problem. And one of the things they got as feedback initially from about, well, they put out this booklet to about 10,000 farmers and about half of them have responded. And based on that, they've decided that they're going to make one significant change. And that is for farmers who are retiring. So normally you have like 3 years to sell a third of your shares every year, for example, if you're getting out of the business. They suggested that with the capital restructure, you could have 5 years. That did not go down well. So now they're looking at 10 to 15 years. That's about the key change that they've made. What they haven't done is made any decision on the shareholder fund, which is owned by non-farmers. In that case, they're still suggesting the best way to get involved is to become a farmer. Because at right this moment, there's no way that they're suggesting that non-farmers will have a stake in the business in the future. So remains to be seen whether that changes. It would be disappointing, I guess, to a number of people that they could have no exposure to the dairy sector. But that could be how it turns out. We'll see. It's only just the start of the process, which they're expecting to get concluded in time for their annual meeting in December.
Okay, should we take a spin around the market?
Let's do that. Okay, so look, Asian shares have slipped, and that's impacted us. We're down nearly, we finished up down 0.2%. That's not a lot. It was only 21 points to 12,652, but certainly there are jitters about inflation, not just here in New Zealand, but around the world. And of course, the Delta variant of the COVID pandemic is upsetting the markets. The New Zealand dollar is at 69.9 US cents. That's about where it's been for a while. And 94.7 Australian, so a little bit stronger there. And 50.8 pence. There you go.
Thanks, Nona. Nona Peltier with Business. It is the dawn of so-called Freedom Day in England, with almost all COVID restrictions now lifted. However, the number of infections is going through the roof. 50,000 people tested positive yesterday, and more than 500,000 people are self-isolating. The Health Minister has tested positive for COVID, and now Prime Minister Boris Johnson is self-isolating as a result. The BBC's Nick Eardley reports.
Life might be feeling a bit more normal, but the impact of the pandemic is far from over. Hundreds of thousands of people have been told to self-isolate in recent days, and now track and trace has hit the heart of government. The Prime Minister and Chancellor are self-isolating after the Health Secretary tested positive for COVID yesterday. Boris Johnson posted this video on Twitter.
We did look briefly at the idea of us taking part in the pilot scheme which allows people to test daily, but I think it's far more important that everybody sticks to the same rules.
This morning, Number 10 said the Prime Minister wouldn't have to self-isolate because of a pilot scheme in Downing Street, which allows participants to keep working if they do a daily test. A Cabinet Minister was sent out to defend the plan.
It ensures that the PM, the Chancellor, can conduct the most essential business, but at other times of the day, they won't be mixing with people outside of their own households.
There was criticism from politicians and businesses who faced significant disruption. And less than an hour later, the government backed down. In York today, sympathy was in short supply.
It was sort of comical, the fact that it was Boris and Rishi. It was, wasn't it? And everyone's thinking the same. You've got a bit of common sense and everyone's just thinking, right, well, they've done that just for themselves so that they don't have to self-isolate.
We've all done everything we should have done and we have done, but I do feel that they should have done the same as us.
Labour's leader was critical too.
The only reason that he's U-turned on this is because he's been busted. It's like
bank robbers who've got caught and now they're offering the money back. One rule for them, another rule for everybody else. It's contemptuous of the British public.
This has been a pretty messy start to a week where government communication is going to be key. But ministers don't want this to be a free-for-all. They will still be urging caution and for people to behave responsibly. In Leeds today, people were making the most of the weather. But with more freedoms comes risk. The government expects cases to rise in the coming weeks. But how high?
I think it's almost certain we'll get to 1,000 hospitalisations per day. It'll almost certainly get to 100,000 cases a day. The real question is, do we get to double that or even higher? And that's where the crystal ball starts to fail.
The vaccine rollout has given ministers confidence, but it hasn't changed the fact that three will spend the first day without legal restrictions in self-isolation.
Alex Campbell is a journalist in England and has COVID-19. He told me he fears the government's decision to open up is only going to make the situation worse.
I think it seems like one enormous experiment, and it's clearly vaccines versus the virus, and the government is staking everything on the ability of the vaccine to keep people out of hospital. And I seriously hope that that's the case, but it's a gamble. And I would say that objectively, nothing that the government has done up until this point in the handling of the pandemic would make me think that I should have confidence in that bet. I mean, COVID's completely blasting through the country right now. Everyone knows someone who's positive. And just in my social and professional circles, not even counting myself, I know five or six people who are positive. And every single one of those people would say the same thing. We've got 50,000 new cases a day. We've got 500,000 people who have been told to isolate by the app just this week. And I think there's something like 2 million in total who are isolating. The Prime Minister himself is isolating. And so into this mess, we're about to relinquish all the remaining COVID restrictions. So, yeah, I mean, you know, you don't need to be a genius to see where we're going.
So basically, you won't have to wear masks anymore. It'll be your choice. Social distancing will be your choice. And limits on gatherings. You could go to a raving dance party from tomorrow. Correct? Am I right?
Yeah, absolutely. No, that's absolutely right. There'll be no restrictions. There's no capacity limit on events, theatres, pubs, bars. It's all back to normal. Masks is discretionary. So just anecdotally, people have already kind of started making their own choices on that over the last few weeks. I'd say I've noticed a hell of a lot fewer people wearing them. So as of tomorrow, it won't be a legal requirement. And except in a few caveat cases, such as Transport for London, where the mayor has made his own choice, I think it's pretty clear where it's going.
It does seem slightly ironic, as you point out, that Boris Johnson is in fact in isolation on the eve of, well, seemingly announcing victory over COVID.
No, it's massively ironic, but it's kind of the cherry on top. It's just we're heading into a situation where we've obviously had the last 12 months that everyone around the world's been able to see. You know, it hasn't gone particularly well, to speak euphemistically, and it's just this is the fire irony that the Prime Minister himself is isolating on Freedom Day. It's sort of a fitting end, but to call it an end is probably not appropriate, because with so many cases rising and so many people getting sick, we don't know what's going to happen next.
Where do you think you contracted it?
I'm pretty sure I contracted it watching England play in the Euro Championship final in a pub, a very packed pub. And I'm not sure if you guys have seen the sort of scenes that we had during the Euros, during the football tournament, but people got very excited. It was an enormous, massive, massive national occasion, and people gathered in big groups to celebrate and to watch the games. And I'm pretty certain that I picked it up in the pub watching the football. And I suspect a great deal many other people did, actually.
And Alex, there were still rules then as well.
Yeah, there were still rules, exactly. There were still at that point limits on the number of people who could sit at a table, for example. But you know what? They weren't being followed particularly well. It's almost like in the build-up to what's about to happen tomorrow, people have started to make more and more of their own decisions, partly because the government's telling us it's down now to personal responsibility and for us to make our own choices. So people have been building up to that of their own accord, even before tomorrow's rule changes.
Alex, are you vaccinated?
I've had one shot, so I'm half vaccinated, which is interesting because, you know, I know double vaccination gives you a lot more protection in terms of both the type of illness you'll have and also the likelihood of catching and transmitting it. But I can certainly say that with half a vaccination, it's still not a pleasant illness, not something that I would recommend.
Do you know which strain you've got?
I don't know for sure, no. You don't get any information on that, but it seems like it's the Delta variant, which originated in India, that seems to be spreading like wildfire through the UK at the moment.
And how would you, well, how would you sum up how you're feeling, literally?
Literally, it started off with muscle aches, and then it turned into what feels like a really bad cold, and then on top of that, fever, and then eventually loss of taste and smell as well. So kind of a bit of all of the symptoms, but it's like having a very, very unpleasant cold and a fever. So yes, it's a mild illness because I'm not in hospital and I don't need emergency treatment, but when it's described as a mild illness, I think it sort of papers over the fact that it's still not a very nice time. And I'm someone who's otherwise relatively young and fit too. But I've still been off my feet for 4 or 5 days now. It's the first day I've been up and about, so...
And can you explain, because it's a different situation here in New Zealand, right? You say you're not so severe that you would need hospital treatment. So are you just left to stay at home? Because that would not happen here in New Zealand if you were positive.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, the instruction is just stay at home and take care of yourself for 10 days. Order your food online. Don't talk to anyone, don't see anyone. If you need to exercise, go into your garden if you're lucky enough to have one. And that's the situation. And you would only seek medical attention if you're really, really struggling.
So what's your biggest fear? Come tomorrow, when all bets are off, what is the fear here?
My biggest fear is that we're giving the virus a chance to mutate into something that's resistant to the vaccines, and we end up doing the same sorts of things that we've done for the last 18 months again come the autumn, because cases are spreading like wildfire here, 50,000 new cases every single day. Not everyone's double vaccinated yet. It feels like we're giving it a chance. And that's something that worries me, because like everyone else, I kind of want to go back to normal or something as close to it as possible. And the very worst outcome would be to go into the autumn and do the same sorts of things that we've been doing for the last year all over again. So that's my fear. For the sake of a kind of symbolic moment tomorrow, we're risking quite a lot.
Now, on the subject of COVID, there has been a release from MIQ, and this is in relation to managed isolation spots for people who are caught in New South Wales. It says, further spaces in managed isolation and quarantine have been set aside for the managed return flights from New South Wales. 530 rooms will be allocated across various managed isolation facilities in the Auckland region from July 28 to the 8th of August. Now, travellers do not need to book a place in MIQ through the normal online booking system. Instead, they will be automatically assigned a place in MIQ once they have booked on a managed return flight. People who have already applied for urgent and exceptional travel before 7 p.m. last Friday the 16th are eligible to be contacted directly about travel plans. These already processed eligible applicants will be given priority for flights from July 28th to 8th of August, and authorities will make any remaining seats available once the urgent and exceptional quota have been processed. Now, travellers must meet a certain criteria. That criteria is outlined on the Unite Against COVID website. So if you want to know if you meet the criteria, go to the Unite Against COVID website. Anyone in Australia who's unable to return home to New Zealand at this time should consider sheltering in place and following all local advice. These spots are going to be prioritised for urgent applications, they say, and there's about 530 rooms that will be released from July 28th to the 8th of August. It is 13 minutes to 6. I'm Lisa Owen and you're with Checkpoint on RNZ National. And Muriaki ina pitapita kōrero. After the news at 6, the Police Commissioner on Violence directed at officers on the beat. Now, a lot of you have been getting in touch about the Orca. You want to know what's going on. So we've just had an update in from Doc about Tor, the stranded Orca, who is in Plimerton, north of Wellington. Now, just to recap, crews have been out searching for Tor's family after he was separated from his pod about a week ago. Now, the search didn't get very far on the weekend because the weather was so bad. However, Doc says an investigation is underway into a pod that's been sighted in the Marlborough Sounds. Now, they're still to confirm whether or not it is
Tours pod, and there are people in the Sounds who are trying to get photographs of this pod to confirm whether or not it is Tours whānau. Late last week, Doc moved Tour into a large pool on dry land because of the worsening weather, and they did plan to move him back into his sea pen today, but they've decided not to do that because of weather conditions. Now, Greater Wellington Regional Council has issued a health warning saying the harbour is currently unsuitable for swimming, which means it won't be safe for volunteers to go into the sea pen with the orca right now. Doc says the calf is still in a stable condition and it's been in its care for more than a week now. They say they're conscious it is a long time for the calf to be away from its pod and mother and to be kept in temporary enclosures. Now, Doc, vets and others are getting regular advice from international orca experts as they make their decisions about Tour. The Royal Commission into Abuse in Care has turned its focus onto Pacific communities. The inquiry is spending the next 2 weeks listening to the stories of Pacific people who came to New Zealand in the 50s, 60s and 70s and onwards and who ended up in either state or faith-based care. It will hear stories of discrimination, sexual and physical violence, neglect and racism. Our reporter Andrew McRae is at the Whale o Samoa in Mangere.
The hearing opened with a welcome and kava ceremony for the Royal Commissioners and other distinguished guests. Woven mats were presented from the different Pacific Island communities as a mark of respect. Inquiry Lead Counsel Tania Sharkey says the experience of abuse and care for Pacific peoples in this country began with the first big wave of migrants in the 1950s, brought here to support the New Zealand economy.
Pacific peoples experienced discrimination as immigrants when compared with how Barlangi immigrants were treated. There was a general preference for Barlangi immigrants, and that preference explicitly enshrined in government policy until the mid-1970s.
She says Pacific peoples have been marginalised and discriminated against and trapped in cycles of socio-economic deprivation.
The resulting disparity and inequality experienced by the Pacific community has created a vulnerability towards Pacific young people coming to the attention of social welfare and entering the care system.
Ms. Sharkey says the evidence being presented will represent the overall Pacific story of abuse.
We will hear from voices speaking to the migration story of Pacific peoples to Aotearoa, voices relating to the circumstances which led to them being placed in care, voices from witnesses who speak to the targeted racism of Pacific Islanders.
She says the theme of silence permeates through the story of Pacific abuse and comes in many forms.
Silence as to ethnicity, including the data and recording of ethnicity of Pacific peoples in Aotearoa. Silence as to shame and fear in a Pacific cultural context. Silence as to one's identity and well-being.
The Crown has acknowledged the courage and strength of the 15 survivor witnesses who will speak at the hearing over the next 2 weeks. Crown Secretariat Director Alana Urukiri says survivor groups have gone many years without recognition. She outlined the Crown's approach.
Is to listen and learn from survivors, their communities and leaders about their experiences with the New Zealand state.
Tania Sharkey says the hearing will give the institutions responsible for the abuse the chance to listen, acknowledge, learn and to make genuine meaningful change to prevent further abuse from occurring.
One of the UK's most outspoken and controversial media personalities will be deported from Australia and won't appear as planned on the country's Big Brother reality TV series. Katie Hopkins was dropped from the programme after boasting about defying hotel quarantine rules. Anei te kaere poata, Max Toll.
My name's Katie Hopkins, and I'm best known for telling it like it is.
I'm unpopular. I'm known as the biggest bitch in Britain.
Katie Hopkins is no stranger to controversy. Her now-deleted Instagram video showing her bragging about flouting the rules in hotel quarantine in Sydney.
I have always called lockdown the greatest hoax in human history. Get to the door and spring it open and do it naked with no face mask.
Katie Hopkins had been brought to Australia by Channel 7 to appear in Big Brother VIP, a decision which was always going to backfire in some shape or form. She's known as something of a far-right commentator in Britain, rising to prominence via her newspaper columns and appearances on reality TV. These Labour Party frontbenchers furious she was allowed in the first place.
Why is Scott Morrison bringing in a right-wing nutjob from overseas when he's got plenty in his own government?
35,000 Australians want to get home, but instead of them being able to get home, we get this self-serving media troll welcomed in by the federal government.
As for the federal government, which cancelled Hopkins' visa, Deputy Prime Minister Barnaby Joyce, as reliant as ever for a good quote.
I'm the one who wanted to send home Johnny Depp's dog. So they've got no problem sending home someone who wants to flout our laws. They want to flout our laws, then you pack your bongo and get out of the country.
Minister for Home Affairs Karen Andrews with a much more reasoned response.
She actually came into the country with support of a state government. This does happen from time to time, and actually it happens reasonably regularly, that state governments approach the federal government on the basis that there is an economic benefit to some people coming in over the quarantine caps.
Ultimately, the joke is on Katie Hopkins. She still has to finish her hotel quarantine period. And then...
we will be getting her out of the country as soon as we can possibly arrange that.
Whether it's melted on a toastie on top of your favourite pizza or piled on a humble cracker, Kiwis love cheese. But what about a dairy-free version? Over the last few years, demand for vegan options has skyrocketed. Now those offerings have been put to the test at a competition in Auckland. Reporter Louise Tanuth and cameraman Nick Munro went along.
It smells really good, really herby.
Nice and refreshing.
This looks like your average cheese and cracker situation, but it's a little different. Dozens of plant-based cheeses from around the country plated up for judging. From a take on a classic cheddar or brie to smoky and spicy, National Coordinator of the Vegan Society Amanda Sorensen explains the ingredients behind them.
So they can be made out of anything from kumara to macadamia nut, cashew nut, and they've got a really lovely component of fat in them for a really lovely cheesy mouth feeling.
There's even vegan fetters and cream cheese, but it hasn't always been this easy.
Only 20 years ago, 10, 20 years ago, vegan cheeses were made out of soy exclusively, and they kind of had a flavour that a lot of people would complain about, a little bit, on the tongue, a soy flavour.
Comedian Tom Sainsbury's part of the judging panel. He's been vegan for the last 6 years and says cheese was the hardest thing to give up. So today's a real treat.
I think cheese was the ultimate one because I feel like with the vegan meats and things for the pies and things and the pastry, they kind of clocked on how to do that quite early on. I think cheese is the pinnacle. I don't think there is anything that's next. I think cheese is the top. Cheese was the holy grail that we needed to overcome. It was our like Waterloo. No, I don't know what reference I'm using. Cheese was the hard one to do, and I think we've done it.
Though he admits after 3 hours munching, he may have overdone it.
Because cheese is obviously rich, and so I'm feeling very, not quite nauseous, but if I had to do another hour, I feel I would tip over the edge.
Aaron Pushy's been a judge in the food and beverage industry for years. Vegan products are new to him, and he's impressed.
I work a lot in dairy, so it's good to see the vegan counterparts coming up with their products, and they're not only trying to copy traditional dairy recipes and textures and flavours, so they're branching out and doing their own thing as well, which is great to see.
But can you really tell the difference? And can we call it cheese?
When you're used to dairy products, you can totally tell the difference, but that's okay, because they're good in their own right and in their own way. A cheese product is one that's usually fermented, and one that occupies sort of a traditional space in our diet. And so if you consider those two aspects, you can definitely call these products cheese. You couldn't call it a dairy cheese, but you can call it a cheese, yeah.
Though some do look different to their dairy-filled twins, the slightly off colour can put people off. The advice is to try it before you make a decision. It was finally time for a taste test of my own.
So what we've got here is one of the entries, which is a traditional take on a cheddar cheese. Now it's made out of coconut oil and potato starch. It looks like cheese and it feels like cheese, but I'm going to give it a test. Now I'm a real cheese fan, so I'm a bit on the fence about this, but we'll see how it goes. Now I'm actually pretty impressed by that. It's got the same texture as a traditional cheddar cheese. It's pretty mild, so it's not super strong, but I'm pretty impressed. I think I'd give that about an 8 out of 10.
After hours of blind sampling and scoring on flavour, texture and appearance, the points are being tallied up. A winner will be declared in each of the 9 categories tomorrow, and an overall winner who's mastered all types of cheese. There's already been competitions for the best vegan snag and pie. After cheese, there's whispers that ice cream could be up next.
Really, Louise? 8 out of 10? We'll put the video up. You guys can be the judge. Without taste testing, maybe you can get a sample and have a look at the video. Let's get to some of your feedback quickly on Westport. Move Westport, this person says. It'll be the first of many. We also need to put out a moratorium on new builds in low-lying coastal towns and tell anyone buying in them that they will not be covered by the government in the future if they are flooded.
RNZ News at 6, Ngā mihi nui ko Susanna Leata wa tēnei. The mayor of Bulla estimates up to 100 people could be left without a home following the weekend's flooding on the west coast. While over 2,000 people have been cleared to return home, more than 100 people are still staying at the evacuation centres. The mayor of Bulla District Council, Jamie Klein, told Checkpoint they now need to start thinking about whether to red zone some parts of the flood-prone Westport.
There are houses that have been flooded multiple times now, so you know, you need to step back and think, is there additional flood protection measures that could be done, or is there just parts of the town that should be, you know, retreated from? That's a discussion for another day, not today.
Jamie Klein says the government might need to help provide temporary accommodation, such as campervans, motorhomes or portable houses. The mop-up continues in the Marlborough region as the scale of the devastation caused by the weekend's flooding emerges. Marlborough District Council says Queen Charlotte Drive will be open for limited access to residents only. Waka Kotahi Transport Agency says only one highway remains closed at the top of the south, State Highway 63 from Renwick to Top House near St Arnott. Richard McNamara of Civil Defence says a bay-by-bay assessment of the Marlborough Sounds has been underway today.
There is a lot of devastation, both in the northern reaches of the Queen Charlotte Sound and into the Kenepuru Sound immediately to the north. The road is being worked on. There's some huge slips up there, massive slips, and worse than that, there's been some severe washouts.
A Bluff maritime pilot boarded a ship where 2 crew members have since tested positive for COVID-19. The Matina, a Marshall Island flagged vessel, came into port last night and all 21 crew members were tested this morning. The 2 infected crew members were given rapid tests as they were both symptomatic. The ship is currently under quarantine. Southport says they were alerted on Friday by Public Health South that 2 crew members on the ship were showing flu-like symptoms and had been isolated. The port says the pilot is vaccinated and followed strict protocols to minimise the risk, including using personal protective equipment and physical distancing. More space has been set aside in managed isolation for people returning from New South Wales. All up, 530 rooms will be allocated across a number of hotels in Auckland from July 28th. People who have already applied for urgent and exceptional travel and are eligible will be given priority for flights. These people will be contacted directly. Airlines will make any remaining seats available once the urgent and exceptional quota has been fully processed. Anyone who was unable to return home is being told to shelter in place. Victoria's lockdown has been extended as the Australian state's COVID-19 outbreak grows. The ABC's Melissa Brown reports.
The Premier, Daniel Andrews, has announced another 4 positive results have been recorded this morning on top of today's official figure of 13 cases. He's confirmed the lockdown will not lift as planned at midnight tomorrow night, but says authorities are yet to finalise how long the extension will last and whether there'll be any changes to the restrictions. Mr Andrews says exposure sites have spread out outside Melbourne.
Stretching from Phillip Island to the Mallee, this is from one end of the state to the other, literally.
The Chief Health Officer will provide his advice on new restrictions to senior government ministers overnight.
Meanwhile, New South Wales has recorded 98 new locally acquired COVID-19 cases. Most of the remaining COVID restrictions in England have now been removed by the government. Mask wearing and social distancing are no longer required, and all parts of the economy can reopen. More from the BBC's Fergus Walsh.
In previous waves, lockdowns were used to bring down case numbers and so reduce pressure on the NHS. With social distancing controls being removed in England, it's now largely up to vaccines to suppress this wave. So we're heading for a face-off between the highly transmissible Delta variant and a highly immunised population. It's uncertain how public behaviour may change. Ministers are urging caution as the emphasis shifts from regulations to personal responsibility.
A nurse who gave a baby the wrong vaccine, then tried to cover it up, has been told to apologise and undergo training. The Health and Disability Commission found the nurse gave the baby an injection to protect against pneumonical disease instead of the rotavirus vaccine. However, the baby had already received a different type of pneumonical vaccine that same day. Instead of reporting the error, the health worker returned to amend the record in the baby's well-child book. It's 5 minutes past six. TJ Perenara will have to prove his fitness for Wellington in provincial rugby before returning to the All Blacks. The veteran halfback is back in New Zealand in the squad for the Rugby Championship, having recently returned from a stint in Japan. All Blacks coach Ian Foster says Perenara will play for Wellington in the opening round of the NPC next month, rather than in the first Bledisloe Cup test at Eden Park.
We have found the guys who come back from Japan just take a little bit of time to get back up to the level that we want. Hence, with the likelihood is that we'll use this Wellington NPC team for a week or two for that.
Ian Foster says prop Joe Moody and midfield back Braden Enor will also play for Canterbury in the opening rounds as they return from injuries. Two South African footballers have become the first competitors to test positive for coronavirus in the Athletes' Village in Tokyo, 5 days before the opening of the Olympics. Eight members of the British Olympic team are also isolating after being identified as close contacts of an individual who tested positive following their arrival into Tokyo. The Football Ferns are spending their second day in the village, but coach Tom Simani says they're oblivious to the positive results.
I can only speak for myself, but I don't find that a distraction because we're just focusing on doing what we need to do as we would going into any other tournament.
The Football Ferns are the first New Zealand Olympians in action in Japan. They play Australia on Wednesday night. That's the news.
Tonight on Nights, Vinnie Wiley looks back on the weekend's sport with a Pacifica viewpoint. Our cultural ambassador from the world of contemporary dance, Malia Johnston, talks about site-specific dance, when the venue is part of the act. And we've got a sofa session with some of the cast of the musical Secret Garden, opening in Christchurch this weekend, getting a sneak preview on Nights with me, Brian Crump, after the news at 7 on RNZ National.
Now the short forecast from Met Service to midnight tomorrow. Northland to Manawatu, including Coromandel Peninsula, Bay of Plenty and Central High Country. Showers becoming isolated and retreating to the west coast north of Taranaki tomorrow morning, becoming fine elsewhere. Gisborne to Wairarapa, also Horowhenua to Wellington. Partly cloudy, isolated showers clearing tomorrow. Buller, Westland and Fiordland mainly fine tonight. Isolated showers in Western Fiordland. Also developing north of Hokitika tonight. Isolated showers everywhere tomorrow evening, turning to rain in the south. Nelson and Marlborough, fine apart from isolated showers this evening. Canterbury, patchy drizzle gradually clearing tonight. Low cloud tomorrow, clearing inland in the morning. For Otago and Southland, fine apart from areas of low cloud or fog. And Chatham Islands, rain, possibly heavy, easing tonight, then turning to showers tomorrow afternoon. RNZ National. It's 8 minutes past six.
Thanks, Susanna. No mai, hoki mai. If you're just joining us, this is Checkpoint. Ko Lisa Owen Thene. Violent criminal behaviour directed at police is ramping up like never before, according to the police commissioner. Video taken at the weekend shows an Auckland police officer on the ground as a man repeatedly swings punches at his head following a traffic stop on Lincoln Road. A 19-year-old man's facing two charges of aggravated assault, willful damage and interfering with a car. Commissioner Andrew Costa explains what happened.
It basically amounted to a scuffle, which led to our officer suffering some minor injuries, and obviously would have been a very frightening situation for that officer.
So repeatedly punched, it looked like, and forced to the ground?
Yes. No, look, it was a very unpleasant situation and the kind of thing that unfortunately happens far too often.
How is the officer?
The officer is doing fine. They thankfully suffered only minor injuries, but would have been a very frightening situation nonetheless.
So what can you tell us about whether police are facing this kind of behaviour more often or not?
Policing has always been a dangerous job, and you know, our people put themselves in harm's way to keep the public safe, and I'm very proud for the way our people do that. Assaults have been on a modest increasing curve, but probably most concerning for us are the situations we've seen more recently that have involved higher levels of violence, particularly where offenders have been prepared to use firearms towards police.
So what's changed? Why does the criminal fraternity feel emboldened?
It's very hard to put a finger on that. Clearly these situations involve a range of things, whether it's mental health issues or drug use. But generally speaking, offenders who are not making the sound decisions that a sober person would make, if I can put it that way.
Do the public not respect police like they used to?
I don't necessarily know that that's the driver, but what we have seen is an escalation in offenders' willingness to use violence towards police. I can't say with confidence what is driving that, but perhaps a change in attitudes of some groups of offenders anyway.
I'm serious when I say this, Commissioner. You know, when you're faced with a situation where someone thinks it's okay to point a firearm at the head of a member of the public, I don't know if you have seen that before, but it happened obviously, last week, and it seems utterly outside of what you would expect to see in this country. What do you think?
I quite agree. No, look, I quite agree with that. And I think the sort of high risk-taking behaviour by offenders is a step up from what we've seen in the past. It is, to some extent, linked to gang activity, but that particular incident wasn't involving a gang member. Media and gaming that has seen this kind of behaviour normalised has some part to play in it, I don't know, but I'm hard-pushed to explain the extent of the violence, the gratuitous nature of some of the violence that we've seen.
So what is the answer?
Look, I think we have to do what we have always done, which is hold these offenders to account and make sure that it's, a very clear message is sent about when offending like that happens. But we also need to look at the underlying drivers of some of this behaviour. As I've said, mental health and drugs are the two areas that stand out where you have a lot of these situations driven by those factors.
So I note with this recent situation in Henderson, someone was filming. Right, I think, and it doesn't appear to be CCTV footage. It appears to be someone filming on their phone, which I'm sure police are exposed to more often. Everyone seems to have a camera, so why not wear body cameras and film it yourselves?
Look, that is certainly an option that we have been considering. It doesn't necessarily stop the violence. It obviously creates good evidence when it occurs. It is something we need to bear in mind when we consider these events, that we see them more now because they are being recorded by people with cameras, which wasn't a feature of offending 10 years ago. And so, you know, it's a lot more striking when you get the footage of it. It doesn't necessarily mean that these events haven't occurred in the past, if I can put it that way.
Understand. There is a school of thought that obviously filming something can de-escalate a situation. Do you think that can be the case?
I don't really think that is a very likely driver for most of these offenders. I accept in some situations that offenders might think twice, but for the most part, when these crimes are committed, offenders are not rationally reasoning through their actions to decide whether they will or they won't.
What are your officers telling you about what's going on the streets?
Look, I think there is an increased level of concern from our people about frontline safety. Obviously, the incident involving the shooting of Matthew Hunt has reverberated through the organisation, and it's caused increased concern and awareness about frontline safety. We've been working incredibly hard through our frontline safety improvement program to improve the training that our people get, and officers who have completed the primary course that we've launched as a result of that are reporting feeling much more confident in how they approach their duties.
And that was Police Commissioner Andrew Costa. Water levels have fallen in Marlborough, revealing the extent of the damage caused by heavy rain over the weekend. As the scale of the destruction is assessed, residents in cut-off areas are waiting to hear when the roads will reopen. Waka Kotahi says just one highway at the top of the South Island is still closed, part of State Highway 63. Now, here's our Nelson Marlborough reporter, Samantha G.
The water might be receding, but many are still isolated. Judy and John Schoen live near Moanui in the Mahau Sound. Slips and damage to Queen Charlotte Drive and other roads mean they're cut off from the rest of the South Island.
The Pukenui Road has had a huge hillside collapse, which has taken out part of the road right down at the bottom, and it has taken out two houses.
Both were unoccupied at the time.
The roar is one thing, but when you hear this absolute rumble and all the bush now is down in the water, we have not coffee-coloured water, we have chocolate-coloured water.
Judy says the neighbours looked out for each other, but they had not heard from council or civil defence.
It is distressing and stressful, I suppose, for us. We've been here 9 years and we haven't really experienced anything like this other than the lockdown.
Further up in the head of the Kenepuru Sound, the road to Ian Hamlin and Kate Betterley's home is also cut off. They were out of communication for 2 days while cell phone towers were out.
This road is susceptible to slips and washouts. I mean, so it is something that we live with. And probably once a year we have a big event like this. Not as big as this. And that takes it out. So, you know, usually not for too long.
Several helicopters buzzed overhead, assessing the road conditions on Monday. Ian says the Sounds is a large network of hard-to-reach places.
Oh, all our rates go on the road. That's nothing else we pay for, really. But the council are great. They do actually keep it open in pretty adverse conditions because it's quite high rainfall. It's unstable and steep and, you know, around the water all the way. So it's a good job.
The couple provide accommodation for those walking the Queen Charlotte track. With no road access, they've already had to change several bookings.
I've got lots of people coming in, and they won't be able to come. We'll have to reschedule just because the track's closed and the road's closed and we're stuck here.
Marlborough Civil Defence Controller Richard McNamara says about 1,100 people typically reside in the Sounds, with around 800 in the worst affected areas in the Queen Charlotte and Kenepuru Sounds.
This flood event's unprecedented in living memory, and as I said earlier, I think the devastation that it's caused is only now coming to light with the clearance of the clouds and the rain.
Others are assessing the damage. Marlborough farmer Matt Forlong arrived at his family's vineyard just west of the Wairau Valley Township to find 200 sheep stranded on quickly shrinking islands and water rising to shoulder depth in some areas.
The sheep would get pinned against the trellis of the canopy and couldn't swim across. So basically had to carry them through. Nearly lost my dogs with the same thing. Basically forced under and then tangled up in wires and that sort of thing. Got there pretty unprepared for what it was. It would have been better with a wetsuit.
His gumboots started dragging him down, so he ditched them. Then, in his raincoat and stubbies, he started swimming the sheep to safety as the river continued to rise.
Not the time he chose to go swimming. Managed to get probably 150-odd clear. There's one that broke back and was sitting in a place that was under the canopy height, which is above 6 foot. And I thought I won't be able to swim there safely to get it out. If I can't touch the wires, I can't hold on to anything.
He only lost one ewe, but they're preparing for a hefty damage bill, as are many others in the area.
It is 18 minutes past six and you're with Checkpoint on RNZ National. Now let's go back to our earlier story. This is about the voluntary poo patrol in Dunedin that were cleaning up the West Harbour walkway. There's a bit of an issue of people letting their dogs, well, you know, do their biz and then not picking up after themselves. These people collected 30 kilos of dog crap over 5 kilometres. That is a lot of dog poo, raising the questions about why people don't pick up after themselves. Now this is Antonia Wood who led the group of volunteers. So some feedback from you all. This person says, Dame Antonia Wood for services to the community. Jackie says, bless Antonia. These disgusting people look away when their dogs do their business, then smugly go back to their own pristine poo-free yards. Thank you, Antonia, and your group. Another listener says, you notice when they do a poo. There's a big lead-up, including a dance around, a few circles, and then the act itself, followed by pretend cover-up scratching in the dirt. You can't tell me that owners don't notice. They do. And then Ro from Invercargill says, how about people picking up the dog poo and then leaving it in the bag on the walk so that it can't even degrade? See it all the time on the Waihopai walkway in Invercargill. Mike says, why do we pay dog tax? And this person says, put up a camera and identify the pooping offenders. Thank you for all your feedback on that one. The New Zealand rowing team hopes to medal again, this time at the Tokyo Olympics. 9 Kiwi boats will take their place on the start line in the Japanese capital. And after contributing 2 golds and a silver at the 2016 Rio Games, they have every chance to match or better that tally this time around. Clay Wilson has more.
Emma Twigg out of the medals. It is Australia 1, United States 2, China 3.
After 3 cracks in an Olympic medal and never making the podium, Emma Twigg had had enough of rowing. And in the wake of the 2016 Rio Games, she gave the sport away. But retirement lasted just a couple of years, as a lingering feeling of unfinished business lured her back for Tokyo.
Something that every athlete dreams of is standing on the podium at the Olympics, and that's still very much my dream. But the Olympics is a funny old game, and you can't expect to just be going and winning medals. You've got to have everything else line up. And, yeah, I just hope that I can fulfil the potential that I know that I have.
There's little doubt about that. Back-to-back fourth-place finishes are proof enough of Twig's capabilities. While she admits those results do sit in the back of her mind, the 34-year-old says they're not the motivation behind her return.
It's more about returning and making sure that I could walk away with my head held high about the performance that I did have, and that I'd ticked every box leading into it and I had no regrets. And like I say, I feel pretty confident in that to this point, and now it's just a matter of going over and having some of the best races that I can. And I think if I do that, then I'll be in a really great position.
Kerry Gowler and Grace Prendergast are not only the reigning world champs in the women's pair, they're also part of the Olympic squad for the women's eight. Prendergast says they're confident with where they're at, despite the impact of COVID-19, meaning no recent racing against their rivals.
That just makes us more determined to sort of like tick all our boxes, because as we say, we're not going to have a test. Like, our next time we race is going to be in the Olympics, and that's going to be 2 years since we've raced. So we know crews can change quite a bit. So I think we sort of see it as a level playing field.
That lack of offshore competition is even more notable in the case of Jordan Perry. The 25-year-old men's singles sculler heads to Japan having never raced an international regatta. Not to mention, Perry is filling the seat held by now-retired 2-time Olympic champion Mahe Drysdale.
You just take a little scroll through Instagram and then you're flooded with just his greatness, and then who's going to be the next, the big men's single scull. So there is this element of big shoes to fill, but I think I'd just like to look at it like I'm just going to take those shoes, resize them for me.
Piloting one of 4 New Zealand men's boats in Tokyo, Perry says he has every intention of replicating Drysdale's success.
A gold medal is something that I am visualising. It is just something that, to measure, is quite hard at the moment as being my first international regatta.
So while on the face of it, COVID hasn't done their games prospects any favours, Emma Twigg says she's more than ready to finally get up on the Olympic medal dais.
I actually feel great in terms of the training that we've been able to achieve in this block. It's pretty much been uninterrupted and with the sole focus of getting it right in Tokyo. But the confusing part is also not having had that international racing, and so I just have no idea what my speed is like compared to my competitors. But I feel like we've really done all that we can, so I'll be looking back with no regrets.
The first test of that speed will come on day one of the Games regatta, with Twigg and Perry among the first New Zealand rowers to hit the water.
Staying in Tokyo, where a growing number of Olympic athletes and officials are testing positive or being forced to isolate with just days to go. The latest big name to rule herself out of the Games is American tennis star Coco Gauff, after she tested positive. But officials maintain it would still be worse to cancel. The BBC's Rupert Wingfield-Hayes has this report.
With 5 days to go, the anti-Olympic protests are not going away. This one is outside the hotel where IOC President Thomas Bach is staying. Their message to him is pretty blunt. Over at the Olympic Village, 3 COVID cases have now been confirmed. Across the city, 1,400 new cases on Saturday. Despite this, when I sat down with the governor of Tokyo, she told me the Games must go ahead.
I believe that not holding the Olympics is even sadder than holding it during these dire times. I do not want to show the world that we have lost the COVID-19. There's still meaning in holding the Olympics in Tokyo despite the current situation.
This was Wembley Stadium in London a week ago. But with just 20% of Japanese vaccinated, there will be no scenes like this in Tokyo's Olympic Stadium. Governor Koike concedes, if Japan had moved faster on vaccines, things might have been different.
I agree. It would have been better. If we had a faster vaccination rollout, we may have been able to have spectators at the Olympics. But the speed of vaccine rollout has now increased immensely.
Not fast enough. This is Kyoto, Japan's ancient capital and number one tourist site.
By now, this place should have been thronged with hordes of tourists from all over the world. For Japan, that was to be the big payoff. Invest billions and billions in hosting the Olympics, and then millions of travellers will come from all over the world to your great cultural institutions, spending lots of money.
Shop owners here have seen sales fall by more than 90%.
It is the government's fault. Look at the other countries like the UK and Taiwan. They seem to be doing well. But look at Japan. I cannot believe we call ourselves a developed country.
Back in Tokyo, hundreds of athletes are now arriving each day. It's now clear that some of them will be carrying COVID. The IOC's assertion that the Games represent zero risk to public health is already starting to look flimsy.
Known for its distinctive engine sound, links to youth culture, and even La Dolce Vita, now the world's most famous scooter, Vespa is celebrating its 75th anniversary. What started as a solution to getting around the streets of Italian cities mushroomed into a global phenomenon and indeed a movie prop. The BBC's Joe Lynham dons his helmet and revs up.
When Audrey Hepburn and Gregory Peck revved up a scooter and ran amok through the streets of Rome in the 1953 classic Roman Holiday, the world instantly fell in love with Vespas. Named after the Italian word for wasp, the two-stroke engine was invented by Corradino d'Ascagno, who designed airplanes during the war for the engineering firm Piaggio. When the Vespa hit the streets for the first time in 1946, Europe was still smouldering after the devastation of World War. With its tiny but reliable 98cc engine, its unbeatable fuel economy and iconic curved design, the Vespa became an instant hit among those who couldn't afford a car but wanted to get on and get around. It even became a verb, vespare, meaning to go somewhere by Vespa. young people all over the world fell in love with the independence, style and mobility that the Vespa offered. That attachment to youth culture was further established in the 1979 film Quadrophenia, in which the Italian scooter was the shiny symbol of fashion and independence between rival English gangs of mods and rockers. More than 20 million units have been sold over the past 75 years, with dozens of different versions of the Vespa, including the latest fully electric powertrain. But the overall shape, style and reputation remains unchanged for the little wasp that flew all over the world.
Okay, some of your feedback now. This on Westport. This person says, 70-year-old born and bred coaster, build a flood wall similar to Greymouth. European countries have flood, sea and coastal erosion protections going back many thousands of years. Blaming everything from stress headaches to hangovers on global warming, climate change is utter diatribe and of no use to people affected by floods. I have survived a deadly flood here and in Australia. Stephen says, I live in Westport, small regional town that no longer contributes to the country's wealth the way we once did. Where would the town be moved to? Even as a small town, it would cost billions to rebuild elsewhere. And a lot of you on the subject of people leaving their dog do around. Shame on people not taking responsibility for their dog poop, this person says. Another person says, good on the team for cleaning it up. And I hope the woman interviewed doesn't bury the poo too deep in the hole she digs. There's a limit to how deep you can bury things when they won't break down, that person says. Well, that's about all we've got time for. But ko te kaupapa, tuatahi o pōpō. I'm first up from 5 o'clock tomorrow morning, what Shane Retty thinks about how the government should reopen the border and how National would do it. Ko wa e wariwari te ata tero I a moto kōrero. Check out our videos and stories online. Back tomorrow.
RNZ News headlines at 6:30. The mayor of Buller estimates up to 100 people could be left without a home following the weekend's flooding. Bluff port officials were notified last Friday that a ship due to dock over the weekend had at least two crew showing COVID symptoms. New managed isolation rooms have been freed up to help get people back from New South Wales. The Health Ministry in Fiji says it has recorded new 5 COVID infections in the east of the country, with the current outbreak previously confined to the western and central areas. Those are the latest news headlines. Our next news and weather is at 7.
Pacific Waves, delving deeper into the